Hello, everybody, and welcome to my brand new podcast, Music to Live For with Shanti. It's me, Shanti, a Swiss musicologist and stage manager, talking with different artists and discussing different topics belonging to the music business. I realized I have many friends who live in Denmark and make really good music. I met Jonathan when he was the lead singer of Skirt by Beauty, and together we trace his musical roots back to his new band, Rod Away. We discuss his passion for fishing and how his life experiences have shaped us. So let's go!
Check this out! Music to live for! With Shanti!
Hello, everybody, and welcome to my brand new podcast. Today, I'm sitting with a friend from Denmark, Jonathan Albrechsten. Hi, man. How are you doing?
All good. Thank you. How are you?
Yeah, all fine. Thank you very much. I know that maybe I just fucked up with your name because I have the worst Danish pronunciation ever. But yeah. It's still a fun thing, this about languages, I think. Man, we met through the music. You were on tour with a band that organized here in Basel. But before we go into that, I'll let you introduce yourself for the audience.
Hey, what's up, everybody? My name is Jonathan Albrechsten. Difficult last name. Probably the worst combo is like a German name and then a Danish pronunciation. what about myself? I do music. I sing in a hardcore band. Used to do it in different bands and used to tour a lot. That's how we met. And now I am working as a physiotherapist. I do a little bit of hardcore music on the side. And then I got my hobbies. I go fishing. I do some Thai boxing and I have a sweet dog. That's it.
Yeah, man. I love the post on Instagram about your dog. Mm. It's so fluffy. I mean, what is for a dog? I mean,
it's a chow chow. He's a cutie, right?
Yeah. I mean, when their puppies are cute, but even now that it's grown up, like it's just four. I mean, like
it's amazing, man. He's just like a life-size teddy bear.
Yeah, I love it. I love it. I love it. Yeah. So
a little bit of a bad dog, though.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, it's like, it's a difficult breed. Like they're super cute and cuddly. And, he's a good dog. He has like good intentions, but like the breed, you know how other dogs, they have this like a wish to like please their humans. Mm-hmm. Chow Chows don't have that at all. They're like cats. They're like, whatever, fuck you, I'm doing this. And they'll just wait until you stop like yelling at them. They just don't care. Like they don't feel guilty when you get upset with them at all.
Okay. Because I'm living right now in a new apartment, and now I'm allowed to have a dog.
Yeah,
I love cats, but I'm not a cat person. So I'm looking for a continental bulldog.
Yeah,
because I have a good friend of mine having two of those, and man, I love this kind of dog because they are kind of, the muscle dog, but also a lot of sweets, you know, like, yeah. I love it.
I like the pit bulls as well. They're illegal here in Denmark.
Also in Switzerland.
Yeah.
I mean, in Switzerland, it's tricky because they are like on a blacklist.
Yeah.
There's a few people that can have one, but in the end, if you pay, you can get it. You know, if you pay the state the permission and everything, and it seems working.
It seems so stupid. I think like the number one, I saw like some data of dog bites in Denmark, and the number one, the dog behind most annual bites incidents per year was a golden retriever.
Yeah. I read something like this, but yeah. Of course, it's I think this got a lot of the honor, but it is. I had while I was a student, I had the chance to go to with these friends during the weekend. There was a place here in France helping dogs with no home. And so it was always looking for people going there for free and go walk in the land with the dogs a whole morning. And so I did it and I had the experience with this. It was for me the first time really being in contact with pit bulls and this kind of dogs. And I just fell in love because they were so, I liked the way that dogs are strong, but the way they look at you, the way they were looking for your attention and the way you could work with them. It was amazing. So definitely hope to find, I would say, a solution or maybe to find a dog, a similar kind of dog, let's say.
Yeah. I think like with the pit bulls, they're amazing, man. You can just tell like they have so much expression. They're like super intelligent. I would like a dog like that, but yeah. I think like the chow chow for the amount of time and I have to put in the effort to like training and whatever. It's a little bit annoying to have like a cat dog around the house sometimes.
Yes.
but like I guess it's the best solution for us because like that's why you get like these crazy dogs that end up biting people. Like if you get a breed that doesn't match whatever resources you have. Then you get like an understimulated or overstimulated dog that's just going to end up going crazy.
Yeah, right.
So right now we have like a super balanced, very nice dog, but he's a little bit like misbehaved, but whatever.
That's in terms of obedience,
but he's super sweet and like he's not aggressive or anything. He's just like, I'll tell him to sit and he'll just look at me and walk away. It's like, oh, Jesus.
Nice. But you're also a fisherman. I saw also a lot of Instagram posts about fishing. It's definitely a big passion of yours.
Yeah, for sure. It's I got the bug and I have had it ever since I was a kid. Just fishing, man. It's life for me. Whenever I get the chance, I go. I switched my schedule around so I have one like weekly day off. So right now I'm out fishing at least once a week, sometimes even two or three.
And so, this is a hobby that you have on your hobby, a passion that you have on your own, or you? I would say you share this in your family or.
It was when I was a kid. It was my stepdad who got me into it. Who really got me into it. And we would go fishing and it clicked for me. Immediately I was hooked and I always wanted to go fishing. And then as I grew older, I sort of neglected it a little bit with the music and everything. It sort of just fell into the background. Mm-hmm. And then I started picking it up again and I could just feel, you know, like, wow, this is just it's just my happy place. I love it. It's a great way to spend time. Like you're in nature, you're outdoors, you're interacting with nature. It's a good, healthy pastime, I think. For me, sometimes it borders unhealthy because I'm so obsessed with it sometimes. Financially it's not healthy as well. I spend so much money on gear, man. It's ridiculous.
Yeah, I think all this is so interesting because it's something that I did. I grew up on a lakeside and so I had a couple of friends. There was a period where I was a child and I remember going with my friend fishing at the lake, but know nothing about fish. It was the idea of being out or you know, this three or four kind of fish that you were able to catch and stuff, and it was a lot of fun. And then in the south there is a lot fishing on the river, and there's a strong community. But yeah, then things change, and then you left this just aside. But so it's still something that I did. I know how it's work, and it's always fascinating to people. That's still in this kind of activities because it's definitely a word on its own, right? It's like when you are into music, you collect gear, guitars or this and that, and you learn how to do this, mixing that. And it's the same like when you have like this kind of fashion, you know, like you know which gear it's the best for that. And you living in a country on the sea, then this is also another reality. Like,
yeah,
you know more also about the territory and how it's working this and that, and 100% fascinating.
Yeah, it's crazy. Like it's sometimes it's even like been sort of like the, I don't know, the underlying current of my life. You know, it's been pushing me in certain directions. And I love to go fishing alone. Mm-hmm. That's probably my favorite thing to do. But then I'll have like, I got really good friends that are also fishing. And they, you, like you said, like you have like the lake and you have the rivers. And like, I enjoy every kind of fishing there is. I also go spear fishing, like free diving with the spear gun.
Yeah.
But I'll have friends that are into spear fishing and not into like rod and reel fishing. And then rod and reel, I have like friends that will go on the lakes chasing the pike. And then I have friends like will go on the coast chasing like the fish that are in the sea. And then, so it's like, yeah, you got these different dynamics going, but I'm just fucking in the deep end doing everything.
Yeah, that's amazing. But what about music? I mean, we met when you were the singer of which band?
Scarred by Beauty.
Scarred by Beauty. Still, I have a t-shirt of yours. I love that t-shirt.
Yeah.
And I love the album.
Is it one of the funky ones? Like we used to do pink ones and like crazy rainbow colored prints.
No. Honestly, it's not a t-shirt. I guess it's a tank top. It's a white one with the lotus flower in the high.
That's from the first album. Wow. Is it that long ago? That's crazy.
Still one of my favorites, you know, like I guess it's one of my guilty pleasure t-shirt bands and everything. But how long did you sing in Scared by Beauty?
I think 11, 12 years.
Okay, so it wasn't like a long time project.
It was a long time. Like, you know Daniel.
Yes.
You've been on tour with him. His brother, Danish, he played the drums. And we grew up together, like went to school as little kids. And then we started playing in like this after school project. We picked up music there. Mm-hmm. And we played like cover songs and stuff like that. And then we started making our own music and we had different bands. But it was just this constant thing from ever since we were 12, 13 years old. We mm-hmm. played together all the way up until Sky by Beauty ended.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Yeah, so it was just like this underlying thing. And Sky by Beauty was not like a serious thing until 2009, I think. Mm-hmm. Up until then, it was, I mean, it was serious, but I was in another band, like a Danish thrash metal band, singing, and I started touring with them a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And I did one album circuit with them, but it was like, it was cool. It was a real nice experience. I enjoyed it, and like the album was great, but the guys were a little bit older than me.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I joined that band as a singer after their first original single left. So they were all 10, 12 years older than me, which like now when we're in our 30s, it doesn't matter. But for me at the time, I was 19.
Yeah.
So it felt like a big difference. And it was a big difference, like from being 19 to being in your late 20s. There's a, yeah.
Yeah.
Those are significant years.
Yeah, point of views, experience, and everything.
Yeah, so I was just like this unexperienced kid, like partying around. And it was great and it was fun, but I was sort of like missing my friends my own age. And I remember we sort of had the talk in the band, Sky by Beauty, like, whatever, are we going to do it? Are we not? Because I sort of felt at the time that it would be like a crossroad where I would either commit to one or the other. And I was also, because I was enjoying like doing my own thing with Sky by Beauty and stuff, I just, yeah, I chose that way. And we sort of amped up our efforts and started like making albums, trying to get record deals. And we started touring a lot. And that's how we met on our first album, I think.
Yeah, because you went, I remember you went a couple of times to Basel, I guess.
Yeah.
Sure, two or three times, yeah.
Yeah.
I sent you yesterday a picture of us in the Villa Rosa.
I was laughing so hard. You look so young, man.
Yeah, right? When I saw that picture. Like, those are the good memories, you know? Like, sometimes you see, you always see in this movie, those old people saying, oh, yeah, looking, you know, on picture on the wall and say, oh, I remember when I was young. And then I say, okay, I still have a good part of really a lot of good memories already now. And it was so funny looking into my hard disk and finding a lot of people that I met thanks to the music, and I still have pictures. And I guess, and it's funny because at the time it wasn't not used to, you know, like now with the phone, you take a shot sometimes with somebody. It's kind of tradition, you know. About that time it was maybe the two people with a camera, or say, okay, let's take a picture together. It was, yeah, sure. Yeah. Yeah. And then you find out that you are these 10 years later. That's cool. Yeah. But
I remember those shows, man. It was crazy. It was, what was his guy name? Chris. Yeah. Shout out. Was it a Thirsty Cold Booking? Shout out.
This is our baby. Our baby is still alive. That's good. Because
really?
Me and Chris, we are like the founder. We are honor members of the Thirsty Cold Booking. But there is a friend of ours, a young guy from Germany, that he took it. And he's doing right. He organized a couple of good concerts in the last few years, and now they're concentrating to producing some bands, local bands. So that's cool because, you know, it started as a hobby, as a passion, and then we said, Chris got a kid. I had to concentrate me on my work and everything. And I said, it was sad to say we need to close or just stop it. And it was good to see that there was somebody willing to take it and keep the legacy, keep going. Yeah, and so
I'm glad to hear that, guys.
Yeah, I found out a video of you boxing. Sorry, no problem. I found your video of you boxing with Daniel.
Yeah.
And, you know, I don't remember the name of your best player.
Chris.
Yes, right?
Yeah. No, I remember that night. That was in that crazy squad, and we found those boxing gloves.
Yes.
And we were on tour with that English band, which we're not beefing, but we were just like busting each other's ball constantly. And I think that they got under our skin a little bit, so we were a little bit irritated.
Mm-hmm.
So Asa, he was the guitar player, he wanted to like, he would have a boxing match with the singer from that band, and he punched him so hard in his rib that he broke his hand.
Yes, I remember.
He couldn't play the show, and we had like a full 2.5 weeks of the tour left. It was horrible.
No way.
Yeah,
I remember it like it was yesterday. And as I said, I still have a video, so I need to. I think we'll send you later. Yeah, but how did you get into hard music? Let's say.
Really, it was because of Danish, who played the drums in Scott. He introduced me to he had cable TV at his house, so he could like watch MTV and like what's the show, Jackass and Viva La Bam, all that stuff, where there would be like MTV hard music, like so he sort of like knew what bands to look up. And at the time it was new metal. It was like Linkin Park and Limp Bizkit, Korn, Slipknot. Those were the bands that sort of like got me going. And I was sort of, I hated going when I was a kid. Like I was a little bit insecure. I didn't like school. I didn't like, I felt awkward, in school and that social whatever. So like the music there was just like, I've sort of felt on the outside, and here was like a something that could define what type of outsider I would be. And that felt really good. And then I just liked the music as well. I mean, it sort of did something for me. And then it just snowballed from there. Like you sort of, like everybody else, like you find one band and like it, like there's a gateway to another, and then you hear something really extreme, and you're sort of like poking around that area a little bit, and then you find whatever genre works best for you in the end. And I guess also when we started playing, it was sort of like when nu metal was at its peak and faded out, and all these other like modern genres would appear that eventually would turn into like this whole metalcore mash in the 10s, 2010s, you know?
Yes, yes.
And from there, I found out about like real hardcore, original hardcore.
Yes.
Which was instantly for me like a genre that I just spoke to me, and I liked the expression, I liked the feeling, I liked the lyrical themes, it was just my kind of thing. And I always wanted to play more hardcore than I think I was able to in Sky by Beauty. It's sort of, you can also hear like a big change on the two albums that we ended up doing. You have the first one, which is very experimental, melodic, and crazy metalcore. Still has that early 2010 sounds very much. And then the next one is more, it has this a more of a hardcore vibe. And not hardcore punk, I mean like the genre, like New York hardcore, the more metal. That album is not New York hardcore at all. Like, I wouldn't claim that. Don't get me wrong. But it just, it feels, it has more of that vibe, right?
I got it. So, but now we can talk about your new band. Because I was, I guess this is a new world that with social network help you to discover a new band. And I remember being on your profile and see, okay, Jantan posted this, Rot Away. And I was intrigued by the name, the logo you put like this. And then I remember when you already put just like a sneak peek of the song, I said, whoa, yes, that's the sound that also I like. I mean, there's a lot of good music out there, but I noticed that sometimes there is these two or three bands that when they got like this kick that is really also the kick that I need or the kick that I like. And Rot Away, man, I already pre-order.
Really? Oh, thanks, man.
Like one more. I remember you posted it, and I just went on the internet and I just ordered it because I want to have it. Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks, man. I really appreciate that. But yeah, it's a cool project. It's hardcore, and it's, I guess, more pure, like a purer form of hardcore than what I've been playing before. And it's like we're four guys in the band, and for all of us, this is sort of like the band that we that wanted to play with our old, like everybody's been playing a lot. So this is just like an outlet for us. We got together on the premise of like, let's just let it go and play simple fucking in your face, gnarly hardcore, and don't worry too much about anything. Just fucking let it swing, you know?
Yes.
And it turned out really great. And my brother is he's the drummer. So
it's a family business.
Yeah. And I was always a little bit jealous of Dennis and Daniel in Sky by Beauty. Like they had this whole brothers thing going, and like I was, now I got that myself. It's super cool, man. And the guys in the band, like the guitar player and the bass player, super cool guys, like super awesome. We've known each other peripherally through like the scene in Copenhagen mm-hmm. for a very long time, and always sort of had this I've always had this feeling like that these guys are cool guys, but never had a real excuse to like sort of start a friendship. But now it's growing, and it's just super nice, man.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So what's the plan now? There is a new album coming.
Yeah, we recorded a full length last year. It's out on a new label here in like a new Danish a core label. It's a sub label to a big label distribution here in Denmark. But the guy who is the owner, he's sort of like very passionate about all core genres and want to like provide a platform for bands like that to start releasing music with a bigger distribution channel. Because in Denmark, it's like Denmark is a very small country, mm-hmm. and the sub genres of a sub genre in total, like metal, are just like they're microscopic. So like if like in Denmark right now, like if you want to release as a hardcore band, maybe you have like two options. If it's mm-hmm. something that has commercial drive to it, there's a whole DIY scene that is very much alive and different. But if you are is it also like this in Switzerland? Because in Denmark, there's like hardcore is like there's two different types of hardcore. There's like the very strong punkish DIY hardcore, and then there's the more commercial sounding hardcore, which are closer to like American hardcore.
It's hard to say because Switzerland is also a small country. I guess it's smaller for sure. And here it's like we are living in the same city, you know. It's not that we can say really country. In what is music scene, it goes mostly about trend. What is trend right now? I saw there is a really cool band called Paleface. They're doing like more beatdown, heavy riff beatdown. Now there is a very good band from Hara, from Basel, doing some that core, you know. It's just like it pops up a band doing this and that. The golden age of metalcore, it's done here. The easy thing of being a small country is that you can advise your advertising your band easily, you know, in your community, through social medias, even talking to people, you know, hey, you know, I'm this band, like this, I'm from Lucerne and I'm from Zurich. You know, it's like 30 minutes train, something like a little bit more. But yeah, just to give the idea, you know, it's really even communicate easy. And so it's great this, but I don't think it exists really, this different kind of subculture, let's say.
In Denmark, it's very it's very much a thing. It's it's not that the two don't mix or that there's but you just have these. You have the whole there's a whole scene that revolves around like the more political active side of music with like real punk bands and hardcore punk that. The bands and that music is only alive in like squatted houses and in the like the left wing underground. And then you have this other side, which is more commercial, sort of commercial is probably the wrong word, but it just has a more commercial form. Like records are released on labels. It's not totally DIY. There's still a lot of DIY spirit, and everybody's fucking working. And there's no money in that either. Mm-hmm. But it's just it has a more commercial infrastructure, and is not necessarily like the bands are not necessarily identifying with like squats and political statements, like left-wing political. Mm-hmm, it's like, mm-hmm. I really enjoy both and I will readily show up, but like the music we play is just a little bit removed from that. Like mm-hmm. the, I'd say it's more true, like true punk hardcore, because yeah. it's very much alive here in Denmark. You have like, we have like some of the big festivals in, there's a squad in Copenhagen with like annual big festivals, like people will travel from all over Europe.
Oh, to, lovely. Yeah.
Yeah.
In Switzerland, those kind of places are slowly disappearing. Because we have almost no more occupied places or squat yeah. places, because this is the Swiss mentality, honestly. You know, like everything has to be squared, shiny. You know, we are kind of proud of the way the country is, and it's sad because through the last decades we have seen a cultural scene growing up here in Switzerland. These kind of places, you know, even from where I come from, in the years ago, it was in the 60s, there was a strong alternative hippie community, and it became really famous for arts in general. And but it's always seen like something, you know, not serious, something, yeah, in this kind of mentality that. You're not an artist, you're just a hobbyist, or you're just a crazy people dancing yeah, in the woods, you know. And yeah, it's sad because we had a lot of great artists in all kind of cultural environment. But it always been a struggle, you know, to they only take you seriously when you start making money and grow your name, you know? So then you are really accepted. And this is just to answer the fact that, yeah, we still have a lot of small concert venues like this, but there's no more. Like Villa Rosenau, there is no more. It burned down, you know? Like now there is a parking lot there. And yeah, in some ways a little bit sad, but I think countries that allow this, I mean, that where there's still this kind of subculture, real subculture, maybe got like extra points in some ways because it's more genuine in some ways. I guess even this scene still have problems. In every scene, we have problems of different genre, but yeah, I don't know. It's the pure DIY. People just go there and do what they really want to do. But on the other side, I also understand bands that they want to promote themselves in some ways, trying to reach in some goals that is have not directly to do to be like successful or making money or like this, but saying, okay, we want to start this band and we want to reach the idea to go to that festival and play. So that's the way you also try to build your path. Let's say, but it's still always interesting to compare and I'll be discuss the way you like in this case Denmark is doing something and Switzerland doing something. You know, I think always interesting because even
you know, it's interesting also because like I think I mean it's similar countries to a certain degree, you know, like European smaller European countries, very healthy economies. That Switzerland a little bit better than Denmark, but it's always fun to like sort of. And that was, I mean, for me when I was touring a lot with Scott in particular, we really got to see that, and that was just like that was a gift. I feel feel very educated from the road, not from just learning to get stuff done when your band breaks down in a different country and whatever. But after Sky by Beauty, I went to school and I messed around for a few years, and then I went to school and did studied physiotherapy. which is my work now. And I felt very old when I started, when I was comparing myself to like my, the ones that I started studying with. Mm-hmm. They were also younger than me, but I could just, I just feel like from the road, I've had so much experience dealing with people that mm-hmm. are just, that translates into every aspect of life. So I feel very blessed with that, at least. Didn't earn any money, but I wisened up, man.
Yeah, I noticed it, you know, like from where I come from, there was this idea when you are 20, 21. We are a wealthy country, you know. So there's a lot of family that could afford to send the kids abroad for 1 year, you know, like Australia, USA, Germany even. But, you know, you don't have to go far. But, yeah, taking a year off. And I just started my studies in musicology. And even for me, that was a something new, you know, like moving 3 hours away from your... from where I live. In between we have the Alps, so you know, it was really a physical border, you know, from where you grow up,
yeah.
The mentality of the place, going the same country but in another place where people think yeah. and speak differently. And so I didn't travel much. I concentrate myself. I was enjoying living here in Basel. And I just took some trip to Brighton or to Germany with some friends and stuff like this, but not really traveling a lot. And then
you still had from like arranging shows and like dealing with the music. And also yeah. Basel, it's like in a, what's the borders are to what? It's like right on
France and Germany.
To France and Germany. So it's yes. like... it's a very international vibe when you get there. You could really feel like as an outsider, when you get to Basel, it feels very different from anywhere else in Switzerland.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Yes, yeah. That's a truth. And then starting touring, not just with bands, but also with orchestras. Mm-hmm. You talk to people, you hear from different kind of situation, live experiences. And then, 3 years ago, I did this great tour with Gostaris, and I had the chance. You know, I've been in 3 weeks, I've been in places that I never been in the last 10 years. And then I was thinking, you know, I'm glad that it happens right now, because now I was like more mature. I know what I was, what I want in my life, or how to see things, how to live those experiences. And I guess if this happened when I was 25, maybe. I for sure had some good memories, but you know, the thing about learning something from what you do, you know, that was the difference, you know.
Yeah. Yeah. I wasn't aware of any of the lessons I was learning in my early 20s. I was oblivious to them. It's only now in retrospect that I realized how much I've actually gained from it. But back then it was just like party hard, man.
Yeah, I remember going with some Italian bands into Austria and Germany. Man, it was just fun. That, you know, you just think, okay, I'm on the road today, that we are playing there. You met these people, you met this band there and everything. And then problems and talks just when I come back home, you know, like, and this is, that's the spirit, of course. But still, you know.
How old are you now, Shanti?
I would be 35.
35. Okay. I'm 33. So we're similar.
Mm-hmm.
You like, I get these fucking dark moments, man. Like it's more frequent now that like where I really fucking miss the feeling of being like 23 and having all the time in the world and like feeling like 10 years would be, that's like an eternity. I can do whatever. And now I'm 30, man. Like days are just like, and that feeling like of being like this in your 20s and feeling super like immortal, mm-hmm, fucking mm-hmm. ready to take on the world. And like you said, just not caring about it. I'll figure it out. It's not going to be a problem.
Yes. Yes. Yeah.
It's like, it's so weird. It's 10 years only from that day where I felt like that from those days. And I feel so much older now, and I'm like, I'm just so scared of like what's it going to be like in my 40s? Like, I'm going to be so depressing.
I don't know. I think that I'm enjoying a lot my 30. Maybe, I mean, I'm lucky enough to have a job that I love. I mean, I'm in a world, in a profession that I wake up and I feel blessed for what I'm doing. And it's not something that just came out from nothing. I built it in my 20s, you know, studying, learning, talking to people slowly, even good and bad experience I had in my life just pop up in a brightening, you know, like enlightenment, like at the end of my 20s. And so I have a good friend who in one song is saying, I died in my 20s and I reborn in my 30s. And yeah. I felt a little bit like this, you know, like I think when I was 20, 24, I was, as you said, you know, the world is mine, or I have the chance to be there. Oh yeah, I'm starting here. It's cool, like this. But now looking back, it felt like a lot subtle, you know, like now I'm feeling like, okay, still days are running so fast, a lot of things to do, a lot of things to economic stuff to think, more responsibilities and stuff like this. But in the end, those things make life more tangible. You know, I'm here. I'm feeling myself with my feet on the ground, and I like where I stand.
Yeah.
But yeah.
I'm really glad that you feel that way. It wasn't like, it's not that I don't feel the same. Like there's different things now that are important. I just felt like my values have shifted a little bit. Now I'm like, I have a nice job. Like I bought this amazing house where I can chill out with my wife and my dog, and things are great. And I'm providing security for myself, like, thinking ahead, and that feels really good as well, and I'm really enjoying it. But sometimes I just get this, like, because like when I was 20, I would do stuff, you know, would go skydiving just for the heck of it, and we would like tour, and you wouldn't give a shit about anything. You just felt invincible, and that feeling, it hardly ever comes around anymore, man.
Yeah, but maybe what comes around when you would be on stage with the new band that you
I mean, like, playing with the band is great. I'm like, I miss that, and it's fun. It's really fun. Also, it's like it's so nice to have like a project where you go, when we play live, it's like every aspect of it is something that I completely dig. It's like everything, I'm proud of it, and every part of it is cool for me. And that's really nice. That's a really cool thing.
Yeah.
And, but it's also tough to play the shows, man.
Yeah. I mean, now everything changed. I think a lot of people still thinking that things gonna be like before.
Yeah.
But it won't. And I see this, but not as something negative, because this period just give us the chance to start something new, or to revisit a lot of situation or a lot of opportunities. So I always been positive in my life, and this is something that I still believe it, that we just need to, you know, to let this situation settle down and find his own balance. But and even for the music scene, it's gonna be a new reborn, because people still believe in that, still want to go to concerts and enjoying the live music how it should be. And so we just need to be patient. It's hard, because last year I had the chance to work in a festival on the mountains, classical music, and it was so magic, you know, because I was here in Basel, you listen to the radio or the TV is always talking about numbers of this and that, and you don't know what's going on and everything. And then you go out, you are in the fresh air, you are in a small village in the Swiss mountains, so, you know, really idyllic. And you can do your work. I was doing my stage management work, transporting instruments, talking with artists, and, you know, like listen to concert for a moment for 1 hour. And it was, whoa, that was something like, it was like 6 months without real live music.
Yeah.
And then it happens once again in January. I had the chance to work for a festival. In this case, it was all streamed, but I was there physically helping to set up the stage and everything. And it was so a good feeling, you know, just sitting there. And it was also there a good friend of mine, shout out to Nicola, was helping me work in there, and he told me the same. We were looking at each other and say, oh, we missed that, you know. and I think this, and that feeling, I think it's going to be the feeling that a lot of people will have when they will have the chance to go back in front of a stage.
Yeah.
And this is going to give the kick.
In Denmark, we can do concerts now, but people have to sit down. Yes. It's like, it's sitting, and it's just like, we've played a few shows like that with the band right away.
Mm-hmm.
It feels so stupid, man, like playing a hardcore show with people sitting down. I know that people are probably like, the people there is appreciative, and it's better than not going to a show, and it's better than being in total lockdown. But it just, like, we've actually discussed it in the band that we wouldn't play, like, we'd play whatever is booked, but we're not going to take any new shows in until people can do their thing, because it's just, it's like, hardcore is, for me, like, a hardcore show is 50-50. Audience, band. It's not something that the band provides. It's something that you build with the guys on the floor. It's a mix, like, and it feels so awkward and stupid. You're like, yo, what's up, everybody? Sit the fuck down, everybody. Stay fucking seated. Fucking sit down. It's like how are you gonna, like, yeah, whatever.
You know, it reminds me of videos that now is also like 12 years old of the American band Bury Your Dead.
Yeah.
And they made like this video, like they are in a cabaret or something like this, and they're playing metalcore, but the audience, like, wearing like in the 30, you know, all the elegant and everything. And, you know, now it's kind of crazy because this is the situation we are living. It's the same,
Yeah, it's fucked up.
Yeah, here in Switzerland, I saw there is a small show, with a good weather. Like, this week, finally, it's going to be like 30 degrees outside, sunny.
Nice.
Because this year, the weather just make us waiting, let's say. And to start doing small kind of festival, you know, where people can walk through, so, you know, and you can still stand on the same place with many people. But, and this is good, but the problem, it's deeper. There is no money, you know, going into the business. And we are not talking about millions, but I'm talking for those small events that normally take place every year. And, like, I was talking with a friend from the south, and he told me, you know, I'm organizing this open air, 2 days open air, where bands from north of Italy and Switzerland come to play, or local bands come to play. People can camping, you know, enjoying Swiss mountains and stuff. But I say, you know, we decided 2 years now, it's done. We are not going to do anything. I don't know. I guess this year, Copenhagen won't happen, right? I guess they just postponed to 2022.
Yeah. Everything, like all the major stuff is postponed
mm-hmm.
and canceled. But from in Denmark, they just like things are going quite well here. The vaccination programs are really building momentum now. Mm-hmm. And infection, like the numbers are like very steady aim going down. Mm-hmm. So from, I think it's 1st of September, there'll be no restrictions on nightlife. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Which I guess also means like music venues, because this the statement was, it just came out like at the end of this week that this, like the different dates where things would open again and restrictions would be lifted. And 1st of September, it said like nightclubs and discos, like full capacity, no restrictions, which I guess also means music venues. But I don't know how many, if there's restriction on numbers, like people's capacity. In the mm-hmm, venue. Mm-hmm. So yeah. There is some hope, like, and it's going to go, it's going to go back to something that you could recognize like soon. But right now it's just like.
Yes. The interesting part is that a lot of bands and musicians in general are using this time to produce good music, you know, like this is something that it's really appreciated, because I'm the kind of person who wear headphones all day long, I would say. So this is helps me keep my heads up. But Switzerland, you know, there was a huge discussion because there was like a fight in between restaurants and venues in some ways, because restaurant could open, then they closed, then just outside, and now you can also eat inside. But at the same time, venues or concert hall, theaters, everything, no, you can't perform. You have really limited persons inside. I don't want to get into politics and everything, but and I understand that it's not an easy situation to deal with so many, I would say, activities that are clashed by this situation. But it was hard. You know, I got a lot of friends working that business that I feel lucky enough, you know, I still work in the music business, but I got a lot of friends that I definitely had to look for something else.
So
I really hope that all these things, the whole things, will help a little bit to think about how arts, music, theater, you know, it's good. I mean, for the health of people, you know, like it's not just that medicine will solve everything, you know. So looking a good movie or go and join a theater or go to a concert, like go and motion, go and just screaming in front of a band is just healthy, you know, like, and I think that many people just forget about it, you know, like.
But I mean, on the same time, it's not something that can go away. It's something that can lie dormant for a very long time, like nightlife, concerts, stuff like that. But it will also, like, once restrictions are lifted, it will pop up like that, because it's second nature to people. It's like you said, it's something that you need. So, and like the business, I know it's tough for the people who were in the industry when the pandemic hit, but it's not something that once restrictions are lifted, people can come back, you know. It's like, I mean, some people would have gone out of business, stuff like that, but it will blossom quickly again. That's my prediction, I think.
Yes. Man, I have like a news. It's not official, but I'm in contact with Pablo, the guitar player from Billy the Kid, and we are thinking about making a band. It's going to be like a distance band, because now he's living in South America at the moment. I guess I'm going to start my career as bass player, you know, like, and this is something that gave me a huge smile, because in the last months I started my new job, and it's definitely another kind of profession. Like, you know, I'm helping managing this agency that we deliver instruments, pianos and grand pianos. We have a great team that is able to move, you know, grand piano to the third floor of you know, to the stairs, and everything is interesting, because it's a work that you need to know, able to handle these instruments, know how to repair a little bit, you know. Yeah. And at the same time, it's really physical, you know. There is also another partner agency from Germany, and they are cool because they're also like, it's like off CrossFit, and on the other side, they transport these pianos, you know. And so they combine the thing. It's interesting. And so new job and everything, but I miss that feeling of playing, you know, like, and I think... So to all the audience out there, if you have the chance to start something, you know, just singing, playing, so do it. You do it, because I mean, we speak for our experience. You're in the music scene since a long day and a long time. Sorry, and me too. I had my experience, and I have to give up to those experience while studying and then trying to collect all the things I wanted to for building my life to have right now. But I'm feeling that it's something that I need, you know.
And yeah, this for sure, man.
This is something
it's so important to follow those feelings, man. Whatever it is, like, you should also be curious to try new things. Like, I have three strong passions in my pastime. But I've tried a whole lot of things. Like, I started getting into gardening, like growing chilies and stuff like that. Whatever it is, like, if you're curious, just do it. Like, and sometimes then you'll find like whatever floats your boat, and you should just pursue that passion, because just like, things sucks when you don't have, like, when that feeling of like missing something. Mm-hmm. Having too much time on your hands.
And I think this is something that we experienced last year, many of us, me too. There's been a moment in between, I guess, May and July 2020, where I was home, I was reading a lot, you know, I decided to start learning Russian and stuff like this. But at the same time, you notice that still something spare time somewhere and everything.
So hard, like, during the first lockdown it was horrible, because like and also for a long time because the gyms were closed and I couldn't go training. And it just like I've been dealing for a long time with injuries, like my shoulder's been a little messed up. I had some issues with my knees, and also recently my back just blew out. It's so fucked up. But like during the time where I couldn't train, it was just, I felt so, I really needed that. So for me, it became very clear, like, what I need to, like, that the stuff that I've sort of picked out and made into like my spare time, these are the things that I want to do and spend time doing. Like, once one of them goes, it's just like, it feels horrible. Yeah. So if you're lucky and privileged to have a life where you have spare time and where you can where there is room for you to like to get that feeling that you need something that you want to, like, that you're curious about, you should do it.
And plan for today. You still have time for go fishing or enjoy time with the dog?
Actually, I have to. I think I'm going to go for a run, because I'm trying to get back into the gym. And then I have to trim the bushes. I bought this house and I have a garden, and it's It's the first time that I have a garden, and it's just exploded the last month, like, because the sunshine has been out. So I need, I've borrowed like this big machine to cut the hedge.
Yeah, I know which one. Yeah.
So I need to do that. And then later tonight, Denmark is playing Finland, I think, in the European.
Oh, yeah. So
I don't really, I don't follow football at all.
Me neither.
But I'm going to a friend's house to watch the game. So
yeah,
I'll just go for the beers.
I think I'm going to do the same because I was on yesterday, play Italy. I got a couple of friends just invited me. But in the end, in the end, I didn't do it because I wanted to do the final mix of the podcast that released this morning. So, you know, like I was into it. But those are also small experiences that just lets you, you know, stay in contact with friends.
Yeah.
And now you're enjoying also more, even go out or see somebody. It seems like, it's such a long time like this. And I was enjoying the garden. I mean, this is also a good activity, you know.
And I'm not gonna, like, even though I'd watch anything, even a fucking cricket game or whatever, if it means I get to hang out with my friends, like, I don't care.
Yeah.
So, man, UFC, do you follow the UFC?
No, not much, but I was curious to see the last fight, you know, the Mayweather and this YouTuber. Yeah. I got the feeling that it wasn't, you know, just something like clown shows. And
yeah, I think that
I just want to see that blonde guy going out in a knockout, but no. So, you know, like,
I spent all morning watching like UFC promos for the fight tonight. So tomorrow morning I'm gonna figure out a way to see it. I'm so pumped for it.
Yeah.
I'm stalker for the UFC, man. They're so good at promoting the cards.
Mm-hmm. Man, I'm not into this kind of sports, but it's interesting to look at it, you know, to see the tactics, the way somebody, you know, want to go for it or not. Or it's definitely interesting. Interesting. And yeah, with guess, it's good also this time to start to learn something new, as we said, and even try to figure it out, new ideas. And you know, I was thinking before we close this episode, would you maybe remind to the audience when would be the release of Rotaway album and where they can find it?
Yeah, for sure. Rotaway, the release, the album is called Nothing Is Good, and it's out August 13 from Last Mile Records. It's a Danish label, but if you just Google Last Mile Records or Rotaway Band, Rotaway Copenhagen, you'll like find pre-order links and you could go check us out, YouTube, Instagram, whatever. And hopefully if you're into like, it's a little bit, it's not old school, but it's sort of bringing that 2000s beat down style back a little bit. Some like a lot of thrashy elements, I think, but it's just straight up like full frontal hardcore. So if you're into that kind of stuff, go check it out for sure. I really appreciate that. And thanks for having me today, Shanti.
Hey, it was a pleasure because it was like a lot of time. I mean, we text sometimes on social media and stuff like this, but it was definitely a long time and couldn't have really the chance to sit down and talk a little bit. So once again, this podcast, it seems to be the right solution to me to have the chance to I would say renew the friendship and everything. It was so interesting to listen to your passion in life and talk your opinion about music and how it's going on in Denmark. And once again, I feel so blessed and so happy that I could have so friends are all around the world where I can talk and share my passion for music. And I thank you very much for your time. And hopefully soon we'll see. I mean, I guess maybe in November this year we will see us. Well, because I guess I will have the chance to come to Denmark, picking the guys for the tour. So we can combine to have a coffee.
Yeah, for sure, man. But Shanti, man, have a great one. Thanks for having me again, man. I really appreciate it. It's 90 minutes gone by like that.
Yes, right?
Yeah, it's good to talk to you again. I hope you have a really nice day and a good weekend.
Thank you very much, man.
Check this out.
I'm really happy to be able to bring you a track from the Danish band Right Away. Their second album will be available soon, and this is Ang Lo.